Now we will learn how to record deposits to our bank account from customers' credit card swipes. A customer could pay a sale receipt by credit card, or a customer could pay a past invoice, which we record in the payments window. If a customer pays by credit card, then you will indicate this at the moment you record the transaction by choosing the payment method, credit card. Everything else is the same as we learned in the previous customers and receivables section. If a customer does pay by credit card and you do choose payment method, credit, the money for that transaction will be recorded into undeposited funds. Payments and sales receipts from customers get recorded into undeposited funds when we swipe a credit card, the same way that those payments and sales receipts would be recorded into undeposited funds if they gave us a check or cash. Think about this for a moment. When a customer gives you a check, you own and legally possess the money, but you cannot use it until it clears the bank. That is the exact same condition as swiping a customer's credit card. At the moment you swipe the customer's credit card, you own the money. You have legal title to it, but you cannot use it until it clears the bank. That's the reason why swiping a customer's credit card as they pay is exactly the same thing as receiving cash or a check. That transaction, that payment or receipt, gets recorded into undeposited funds. Credit card swipes usually go into undeposited funds on the day of the sale, and then it could take 2 or 3 business days till the money finally gets deposited into your bank account. After you log into your bank account and observe that the credit card swipe has cleared, then you record the deposit. Before we can record our first example, we have to set up the file to receive credit card swipes by adding an expense account in the chart of accounts called credit card processing fees. That's because the merchant that gives us the credit card charges a fee every time a customer swipes a credit card, and we collect that money and it gets deposited into our bank account. From the main menu, click List, Chart of Accounts. In the bottom left, click Account, New. The type is Expense. When you click Continue, Expense is still chosen as the type. Make sure your cap locks is on and type Credit Card Processing Fees. And this account in the Chart of Accounts will hold all of the processing fees every time you swipe a customer's credit card. After our first example, we will be charged a fee and this account will show up on the trial balance. Now let's imagine on March 24th, Holden did 9 video hours for Candy. She paid by swiping her MasterCard with this number and this expiration date. The white piece of paper that came out of the credit card machine gave this number as the unique number that identifies the transaction. Because she did pay immediately, we will make a sale receipt. The customer was Candy. The date was March 24th. The item was video and the quantity that she did was 9. Okay, so for the most part, this was a normal sales receipt like we learned before. We click in the check number field to put the number from the slip that came from the credit card machine. The unique number that identifies this transaction from the credit card slip was 8765432. Now the last thing you have to do is record the payment method. If the customer paid by credit card, you would click this button here. Notice the Enter Credit Card Information window opens up. I'm going to move the sale receipt window over a little. Again, click the payment method for credit card. It just so happens Candy was paying with a MasterCard. When you click card number field, Be very careful to type it in carefully, because once you type it in, you will not be able to go back to that field to see the numbers that you typed in. When we click away from the field, QuickBooks X's out the first 12 out of 16 numbers, and you can never see them again. Put in the expiration date 2/18, click Done, and now we've done everything we need to record this sale receipt. Click Save and Close. Now let's imagine on March 25th, we logged in and observed that Candy's $2,700 has cleared. However, the money amount that was deposited in our bank account was not $2,700. The money amount deposited was really $2,673 because the merchant that processed the credit card took off $27 as a processing fee. Let's take a look at how to record this. From the main menu, click Banking, Make Deposit. And of course, the two windows that we learned about before open up. In order to find the deposit from Candy's credit card swipe, it would be easier to change the Sort By to Sort By Date. This way we can scroll all the way down and see the most recent payments that we have received. Here it is. When we click on it, we're selecting it and we click OK. Now we get to the deposits window. Make sure we put the date that it was physically placed in our bank account. However, when we log into our bank account online and look at the money amount that we got from Candy, it's not the $2,700. The merchant put minus $27 as a fee. So we click one row under the deposit and put minus 27 and push tab. That lowers the amount of the deposit to the actual amount that we saw when we logged into our bank account online. In the From Account column, we click directly under Undeposited Funds, click the pull down arrow, and we choose the expense account that we set up earlier in this video. And now we confirm that $2,700 is coming out of Undeposited Funds, $27 is going into the expense credit card processing fee, and the difference of $2,673 is actually what was physically deposited into the cash in bank. When we click Save and Close, we can open our trial balance and we can see now that credit card processing fee expense shows up for the first time as $27. If we double-click cash in bank and scroll to the bottom, we can see that the actual amount that we record in our QuickBooks for cash in bank, $2,673, matches what was in the computer when we logged into our account online. And of course, if we double-click on deposited funds and scroll to the bottom, we can see that $2,700 went into undeposited funds when we swiped the card, and the full $2,700 came out when we deposited the money into the bank. QuickBooks allows you to save the credit card information in the permanent records of the customer. We know the permanent records of the customer is in the customer center. For example, let's imagine that this MasterCard with this number and this expiration date is Alan Arby's credit card, and he wants us to keep it on file permanently so we can use it for future transactions. From the main menu, click Customer, Customer Center. Double-click on the customer that we want, and the Edit Customer window opens up. Remember, there are several tabs of information in the customer's permanent records. Click the Payment Settings tab. And in the bottom left here is the credit card information. Here we go. Let's type it in. Credit card number 12345678901234. Expiration date is February of 2018. Name on the card, Alan Arby. And then, of course, we would normally put Alan's address and zip code. and then we would click OK. Now, be warned about one very important point. Once the information is saved in the permanent customer records, only the QuickBooks administrator can see this number. Only the person who's logged in as the administrator can reopen the customer center, reopen the customer's records, and see the credit card number that is permanently put on file. You will learn in a later video what it means to be the QuickBooks administrator when you watch the security tools video about usernames and passwords. The reason why I can reopen the customer center, double-click Alan, and click on his payment settings is because I'm logged in right now as the administrator. You will automatically be logged in as the administrator if you did not set up usernames and passwords. Let us imagine on March 26th, Alan paid in full the balance of his invoice number 21. He paid this with the MasterCard that he has on file, and the slip that came out of the credit card machine had a unique transaction number that identified this credit card swipe as 11223344455, a nice easy number to remember. Currently, the balance of Alan's invoice number 21 is $4,000, so the actual amount of the charge is going to be $4,000. We open the payments window, and of course we choose customer Alan RB and collapse the ribbon so we can see all of his open invoices. We make the date March 26th. When we choose payment method credit card, QuickBooks remembers that Alan RB had a MasterCard ending in 1234, and this information came up because it was saved with Alan's permanent records. If Alan agrees he's paying with the credit card on file, just click Done. Now, put $4,000 in the payment amount because that's the amount of the charge. When you push Tab, you remember that QuickBooks finds the exact match of any invoice that has the balance due of the same amount of the payment. Now all we have to do is put the reference number from the slip that came out of the credit card machine. 11223344455. Now we're finished recording Alan's credit card charge to pay a previous invoice with the credit card that we put in his permanent file. Click Save and Close. March 27, we logged into our bank account online and observed that Alan's charge cleared the bank. Well, how do we know which one is Alan's charge? Well, the original charge was $4,000, but the fee was $40 because you remember the fee is 1%, and that's what the credit card merchant processor takes as a service fee for processing Alan's credit card. Therefore, the net amount that was deposited into our bank account on March 27 was $3,960. From the main menu, we click Banking, Make Deposit. Notice the payment window comes up. To see the most recent payments and credit card swipes, sort this window by date and scroll all the way to the bottom. Here's Alan's charge on his MasterCard, and here's the transaction number that went with it. When we click on it to choose it, we can click OK, and then we return to the Make a Deposit window. We confirm which bank account the money's going into, and of course, in the date box, we put the date that it was actually physically placed into our bank account. We're almost finished, except we have to deduct the fee. We know that the fee was $40. We click one row below the 4,000, type in minus 40. Then when we push Tab, we notice the total of the deposit decreases to the actual amount that was physically placed in our bank account. Click directly under the word undeposited funds, then click on the pull down arrow to choose the account that will hold the fee. The account that records credit card processing fees is down here. We put it on the list earlier. credit card processing fees expense. So undeposited funds will decrease by $4,000. Credit card processing fees expense will increase by $40. And cash in bank has already increased by $3,960, and now we're recording it. When we click save and close, we can open the trial balance and see credit card processing fees is up to $67 from a moment ago. If we double click, we can see both transactions where we charged a customer's credit card, and we can see the fee for each individual one of those transactions, adding up to the total that we pay for credit card processing. If you double click cash in bank, you notice that the very last transaction matches what's in your account online. March 27th, the credit card merchant deposited $3,960 into your bank account. If you double click on deposited funds and scroll all the way to the bottom, you see that Alan's charge went into undeposited funds for the full amount, and therefore came out of undeposited funds for the full amount.